Welcome to Design of Machine Element 2, second module. Today we'll start with a new topic, that is design of wire ropes. In that we need to know about what are the characteristics of wire ropes, and the main thing is construction of wire ropes, stresses in wire ropes, and selection of wire ropes for a particular application. So coming to the rope drive, of course we have already studied like one of the important drive, that is belt drive. So we have some of the advantage of a belt drive, even though some of the limitation. The one of the main limitation is whatever the power that can be transmitted moderate with the help of flat belt drive, and whatever the power to be transmitted only for a limited distance, we can say 8 meters. So we cannot go for more than that one. So that's why the best option is always rope drive. The rope drives are widely used where a large amount of power is to be transmitted from one pulley to another pulley, so over a considerable distance, we can say more than 8 meter when the pulleys are located. So we can transmit the power effectively with the help of rope drive. So that is one of the important characteristics of rope drive. In rope drive, there are two types of ropes we are going to use. The one such ropes is fiber rope. So as the name implies, the rope is made up of natural fibers, and second one, that is called wire ropes. So we'll discuss one by one. So these fiber ropes are operate successfully when the pulleys are about 60 meters apart. When the two pulleys are 60 meter apart, then the best option is fiber ropes. But the wire ropes can be used when the distance between the two shaft or two pulleys are up to 150 meters, then we have to go for wire ropes. So these two are important types of ropes that can be used in rope drives in order to transmit a large amount of the power from one shaft to another shaft. The fiber ropes are usually made from fibrous material, such as you can see that is hemp, one of the best example. And manila or cotton. So this type of material is used to make fiber ropes. Since the hemp and manila fibers are rough in nature, so therefore whatever the ropes made from this fiber are not very flexible and possess poor mechanical property as compared to wire ropes. We'll see what are the characteristics of wire ropes later. The hemp have less strength as compared to manila ropes. When the hemp and manila ropes are bent over a sheave, that is nothing but a pulley, so there is some sliding of fiber takes place. Results there will be a rope wear takes place. So that's why the whatever the advantage of using this type of fiber rope is limited as compared to wire ropes. And whenever the distance power to be transmitted up to 60 meters, then only we can go for fiber ropes. Now coming to the wire ropes, when a large amount of power is to be transmitted over a long distance from one pulley to another pulley up to 150 meter apart, so then wire rope is used. Wire ropes are used, and the application of this ropes are mainly used in elevators, mine hoist, cranes, conveyors, hauling device, and suspension bridges. You can find application of this type of ropes, that is wire ropes, mainly in cranes, conveyor, elevators. So these are the one of the important examples of wire ropes. The various material used for wire ropes in order to increase the strength are wrought iron, cast steel, extra strong cast steel, floss steel, and alloy steel. So these materials used in wire steels, so that's why the strength is good as compared to fiber ropes. That's why in most of the application wire rope is used instead of using fiber ropes. For certain application the wire ropes are used, that is made up of copper or bronze or aluminium, or it may be made up of stainless steel. So the main thing here is whatever the wire ropes that will run on the groove pulleys, so that will rest on the bottom of the grooves, so and are not wedged between the sides of the grooves, as you seen already in the V bell drive. So there will be a wedging action, but here you will not get wedged between the sides of the groove. Now coming to the construction of wire ropes, the wire ropes are made from various grades of steel wire having a tensile strength ranging from 1200 to 2400 megapascal. So we have already discussed what are the materials, but the main strength requirement starting from 1200 to 2400 megapascal for various application. The steel wire ropes are manufactured by special machines. So the machines we have different machines in order to make the these wire ropes. We'll see how to construct these wires. The number of wires such as 7, 19, 37 are twisted into a strand, and then number of strand usually 6 or 8 are twisted about a core or center to form the rope. So this is the important construction, that is 7, 19 or 37 are twisted into a strand, and then number of strand usually 6 or 8 are twisted about a core or center to form the rope. So that we'll see in the next slide. The core may be made up of hemp or jute, asbestos, or a wire of sulfur steel. So this is the one of the important construction you can see here. So this is the core. So 6 × 7 rope means it indicates 6 is the number of strand. Here you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 strand, and 7 indicates number of wires in that strand, that is total 7 number of strand. You can see here 3 here, 3 outside, and 1 exactly at the center. So that indicates 6 into 7 rope. So this is one of the important construction of wire rope. You can see wire will be always like this. And coming to the one more construction, that is 6 into 19 rope. So 6 indicates again same, the number of strand that will be 6, usually 6 or 8, but most of the engineering application the number of strand will be 6, and the whatever the wire inside that strand is 19. Here you can see, if you count, so 19 wires having the small wires. So that wires are always stronger per cross sectional area, so that will give you excellent tension, and it may be flexible. You can wound easily. That is the characteristics of wire rope. And coming to the 6 into 37 rope, so again there will be 37 number of wires,
and six strand. So centrally it has a core. The core usually made up of hemp or jute or asbestos material. So this is the construction of 6 into 17 rope. Advantage of wire ropes. So because wire ropes has a lot of advantage than fiber rope. So one such advantage is it is lighter in weight. So that's one of the advantage. And whatever the operation, that will be silent. It will not make you a mix or noise, and it can withstand shock loads, as like a bell drive. So this also withstand shock loads, and these type of drives are more reliable as compared to other drive. And whatever the ropes, wire ropes, having durable as compared to fiber ropes, as well as any other type of ropes. So wire ropes are always having high strength, as well as life of this wires are also very high, and it will not fail suddenly as compared with any other type of wire ropes, sorry, any other type of fiber ropes. So that's why the efficiency of this type of drive is very high. So that is the some of the advantage of wire ropes. Now next slide, we'll see about design of wire ropes. So stresses in wire ropes. Wire rope may be subjected to following types of stresses. We'll see one by one. The first one, that is direct stress due to axial load lifted and weight of the load. So if you consider a load to be lifted, that is nothing but W, and small W is nothing but weight of the rope, and A is the net cross sectional area of the rope. So that is the direct stress, or you can find out, that is sigma D is equal to W by A. And coming to the second stress, that is bending stress, when the rope winds round the sieve or drum, so you'll get a bending stress, that is K into dW divided by D. So equivalent bending load is given by FB equal to sigma B into A, that is equal to KA into dW by D. So you'll get you can find this equation from 14.20B. So where D is nothing but pitch diameter of sieve, dW is nothing but diameter of a wire in ropes, A is the net cross sectional area of the rope, FB is the bending load, and K is nothing but constant of proportionality. So this you can find with help of this equation, that is 14.20B. So this is the second stress. The first one is nothing but direct stress. So equation is force by area. So force is nothing but here load to be lifted, and we have to add weight of the rope, so divided by net cross sectional area of the rope, that will give you the direct stress. Similarly, bending stress can be calculated with the help of this equation, that is 14.20B. Now third stress, that is stresses due to starting and stopping, that is sigma A, that is given by W plus W divided by G into A divided by A. So here W is nothing but what is the load to be lifted, this is weight of the rope, and A is nothing but acceleration due to gravity during sudden starting or stopping, and A is nothing but net cross sectional area of the wire rope. Now coming to the fourth stress that may induce in the because of speed, the additional stress due to change in the speed may be obtained in the similar way. Now fifth one, that is effective stress. The effective stress can be calculated by adding all the stresses, that is direct stress sigma D and bending stress. So it's called effective stress in the rope during normal working. So it can be written as mathematically sigma d plus sigma b. So that is effective stress in the rope during normal working. Effective stress in the rope during starting is given by sigma st plus sigma b. That is the starting stress or stresses due to starting and stopping. Effective stress in the rope during acceleration of the load. So we have to add sigma a plus sigma b plus sigma d. So this is about five different types of stresses that may act in the wire ropes. Now coming to the last part in the wire ropes, that is selection of wire rope. How to select particular wire ropes, because we have seen different constructions, that is 6 into 9 or 6 into 17, so different types of construction. How to select particular wire ropes for particular application, that also plays very important role. So for that purpose, we have different manufacturers catalog, that is suitable type of rope from table. From your data and book, you have to go through this table, that is table 14.25, 14.26, 14.27, 14.28, 14.29, 14.30 for the given application. So this is the selection of wire ropes for particular application. Now coming to the next type of power drive, that is chain drive. So already we discussed about important types of power drives, that is belt drives, rope drive, and this is the last one, that is chain drive. So in chain drive, you know, instead of a belt, we have to use chain. So a chain drive consists of endless chain, so that will be wrapped around two sprockets. So we'll discuss, we'll show you the diagram in the next slide. A chain is nothing but a series of links that is connected by pin joints, because you can see here the chains are made up of a number of rigid links which are hinged together by means of pin joints in order to provide necessary flexibility for wrapping around the driving and driven wheels. So whatever the driving and driven wheels, so that wheel having toothed projection, so that's why it is called toothed wheel. It's also called sprocket wheels, or simply we call it as sprocket, because we used pulley in case of that is belt drive, but here we have to use sprocket for transmission of power from one shaft to another shaft. So here the main thing is to avoid the slipping. That's why we have to use chain, because this almost consider as a positive drive, because we have a slip will occurs in case of a flat belt drive. So that's the main drawback. So in order to maintain constant velocity ratio, so we have to go for chain drive. So but here also in chain drive also we have a certain drawbacks that also we'll discuss later. The sprocket and chain are thus constrained to move together without slipping. So that is the main characteristics of chain drive. There should not be any slipping and ensures perfect velocity ratio. So that is the characteristics of chain drive. The chain drive is intermediate between the belt and gear drives. Always the gear drive is you'll get more velocity ratio, but in belt drive you'll get usually less velocity ratio because of slip. But the chain drive, so that will be lies between the belt and gear drive. So it has some feature of belt drive along with the some feature of gear drive. So we'll see what are the advantage of chain drive that with the compare with the belt drive as well as gear drive. So that also we'll discuss later. The main thing is here the sprocket, a toothed wheel is used, that having a special profile for a for the teeth. It has a teeth projection, so in order to avoid the slipping. So that is the main characteristics of chain drive. So this is the diagram of chain drive. So here you can see the flexible element is nothing but chain. So that is endless chain. So that will be wrapped around two sprocket. We call it as, so this is tooth projection. This is called a sprocket. Here also you can see. So this is almost similar to open bell drive. If this moves in clockwise direction, that is a driver. So we call it as this is a driving sprocket, and this one is called driven sprocket. So that can be used to transmit power from one shaft. So this is the we can couple to shaft. You can see here these two, and you can transmit power from one shaft to another shaft over a longer distance. That is possible, but in gear drive you cannot possible for a longer distance. And intermediate link is nothing but chain. You can see here there will be a chain instead of a belt. You can intermediate link in case of a belt drive is a belt, in case of a rope drive it is a rope, but in case of chain it is chain. Some of the advantage and disadvantage of chain drive over belt and rope drive. So the main advantage is, as no slips take place during the chain drive, hence perfect velocity ratio is obtained. So this is one of the important advantage. Since the chain are made up of metal, therefore they occupy less space in width than a belt or a rope. And coming to the third one, it may be used for both long as well as short distance. Fourth one, it gives high transmission efficiency, up to 98% is possible with the help of this type of drive. And it gives less load on the shaft. It has ability to transmit motion to several shaft by one chain only. So that also possible here. And next advantage is, it transmit more power than belt. So that's why chain drive can be used for transmitting more power from one shaft to another shaft. It permits high speed ratio of 8 to 10 each to 1 in one step. This is nothing but speed reduction is very high as compared with the rope or belt drive. So that also possible. It can be operated under adverse temperature and atmospheric condition, but a belt may subjected to some changes with respect to temperature and atmospheric condition, but the chain that will operate under this condition also. Now coming to the disadvantage, the production cost of the chain is always high, because you know the whatever the flexible link is nothing but a chain. The chain is always made up of number of joints, pinned joint, so that production of this chain also challenging one. So that's why it leads to more cost. And second one, the chain drive needs accurate mounting and careful maintenance, particularly lubrication also needed. But in belt drives and all, the lubrication is not required at all. But for chain drive, the lubrication is necessary, and maintenance also it requires maintenance. So along with the whatever the adjustment, that also needed for the chain drive. Now coming to the types of power transmission chain. So there will be three important types. The first one is block or boost chain. So these types of chains are usually used for transmission of power from one shaft to another shaft. But when the distance between the center of the shaft is short,
and these chains have a provision for efficient lubrication. So based on this, we have one such type that is called a block or a bush chain. So you can see here, this is a chain arrangement under this type, that is block or bush chain. So this type of chain was used in the early stage of development in the power transmission. So that is called block or bush chain. It produces noise when approaching or leaving the teeth of the sprocket because of rubbing between the teeth and limbs. So that is the characteristics of block or bush chain. Now coming to the another type, that is important chain, that is bush roller chain. It consists of outer plates. You can see here, consist of outer plates or roller link plate. So inner plate is nothing but a roller link plate along with the pin, that is nothing but here pin, you can see. And outer plate, it's also called pin link plate, so along with the roller. So a pin is passes through the bush, which is secured in the holes of the roller between the two sides of chain. The rollers are free to rotate on the bush, which protect the sprocket wheel teeth against the wear. So the pin of the pin as well as the bush and the roller usually made up of alloy steel here. So this, that is called a bush roller chain. And coming to the different types of chain of different arrangement. So we have a simplex chain, duplex chain, and a triplex chain. These are the classification of roller chains that are standardized and manufactured on the basis of page. So these chains available in single row or multi row. So you can see, if it is single row, it is called a simplex chain. If it is double row, then we call it as a duplex chain. If it is third row, then we call it as triplex chain. So that is we called chain as well as this. These are nothing but a strand. So this is called a strand. So this arrangement is called. There are three important arrangement. One is simplex, duplex, and triplex chain. Now one more type of chain, that is called a silent chain. This is also called a inverted tooth chain. So this will produce, it will not produce any noise. For noiseless operation, this type of chain is recommended. So when the chain stretches and the pitch of the chain increases, the link ride on the teeth of the sprocket wheel, so it is slightly increased radius. So that's why it will automatically corrects the small change in the pitch. So that is the one of the characteristics of silent chain. So there is no relative sliding between the teeth of inverted tooth chain and the sprocket wheel teeth. So it has to lubricate properly, and this chain will give a durable service for a longer period of time, and whatever the working of this type of chain is very smooth. So this is about silent chain or inverted tooth chain. Now coming to the next topic, that is mode of failure for chain. So there will be a different modes of failure of chain, that is we'll see one by one. The first one is wear. The wear of the chain is caused by articulation of pin in the bushing. Because of this wear, there will be elongation of the chain. The wear is the one phenomenon, so that happens usually in the chain drive. The second one is fatigue. So as the chain passes around the sprocket wheel, it is subjected to a tensile force, which varies from maximum on the tight side
to a minimum on the loose side. So the whatever the stresses that may varies from minimum to maximum. So during one complete cycle, so there will be an alternative stresses, that is maximum and minimum stresses. So because of this one, the fluctuating stresses takes place for every revolution of the sprocket wheel. So because of this, there will be fatigue failure. So what we discussed already, what you mean by fatigue failure, and of the chain takes place, that is nothing but failure of the chain takes place because of fatigue load. Now coming to the third one, that is third failure, is we call it as impact. So that is nothing but the engagement of rollers with the teeth of the sprocket, so results in impact. So when the excessive takes place, this may lead to breakage of the roller or bushing. So that is called impact. So when the excessive, this may be lead to breakage of the roller or bushing. So increasing the number of teeth on the sprocket or reducing the chain tension and speed, that will reduces the whatever the magnitude of the impact force. Now coming to the fourth one, that is last mode of failure, that is galling. So galling is a stick slip phenomenon. So that between the pin and bush, so when the chain tension is high, so welds are formed at the high spot of the contacting area. So this is nothing but one such phenomenon, that is nothing but stick slip phenomenon. So when the tension is very high, so welds are formed at the high spot of the contacting area. So there will be a contact region, so in that microscopic welds are formed. So we have to immediately these welds are immediately broken due to relative motion of the contacting surface and leads to excessive wear, so even in the presence of lubrication. So that is the main phenomena of the failure, that is nothing but galling. Now coming to the lubrication of chain, the frictional losses in the chain drive consist of following factors. The first one is loss due to friction between the rollers and bushes. Second one, loss due to friction between the bushes and pins. Third one, loss due to friction between the sprocket teeth and the rollers. The efficiency of a well lubricated chain drive is from 96% to 98% because of frictional losses. The main objective of the chain lubrication are to reduce the wear of the chain components, to protect the chain against rust and corrosion. So I already know these are the general objective of any kind of lubrication. And third one, to carry away the frictional heat, because a lot of heat is generated, so the heat should be carried away from the region. So that is the main function of lubrication. And fourth one, to prevent the seizure of pins and bushes. Fifth one, to cushion shock loads and protect the chain. So these are the main properties of or objective of the chain lubrication. So there are three basic methods for the lubrication of chain. So they are designated as type A. So type A is nothing but manual or drip lubrication. Type B is nothing but bath or disc lubrication. And type C, bath or disc lubrication. So the type depends upon the power rating and velocity of the chain. So we have a lot of things under this lubrication type. In type A lubrications, it's nothing but a manual or a drip lubrication. The lubricating oil is applied to the chain links with a brush or an oil. So can after every
8 hours of operation. So that is nothing but
type A lubrication, but in type B we call it as bath or disc lubrication. In bath or in this lubrication, so whatever the lower side of the chain is made to pass through a sump, so that containing lubricating oil, so that is called bath or disc lubrication. And third one, that is type C, it is not bath or disc lubrication, so here it is mistake. So type C is nothing but oil stream lubrication. Type C, all of you make note here. So type C is nothing but oil stream lubrication. In this method, there is a separate oil pump, so which supplies a continuous stream of lubricating oil to the chain. So the oil is applied on the inside of the chain loop. So that is about type C. It's called oil stream lubrication. So these three are important type of lubrications, that is nothing but chain lubrication. So this is about all four important types of drive, that is rope drive, a bell drive, and chain drive. So we already studied in third module, that is one more drive, that is rigid drive, is nothing but gear drive. So that completes all your power drives. Next class we'll move towards one more important topic, that is springs, design of springs. We have to study about different types of spring, so that we'll discuss in next class. Thank you.